Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Married People Podcast, where we want to make marriage real, fun, and simple. This episode, we're looking at the question, how does depression impact my marriage? Now, my co-host, Ted Lowe, sat down for an interview with friend of the podcast, Todd Graham. Todd is a speaker, author, and the family pastor at Eastside Baptist Church in Atlanta, Georgia. He's got many years of experience leading marriage and family ministries at a few different churches across the country. Todd's been married for 19 years and has three kids. Todd's also been very involved with married people over the years. He's written for our blog, he's spoken at our conferences, and he's been a tremendous leader behind the scenes. But perhaps our favorite thing about Todd is his transparency. Todd gives us so much hope through what he does by being real about the tough stuff. Todd shares with Ted about his struggle with depression, the impact it's had on his marriage, and how he's learned to handle his depression in a way that's actually helpful and empowering to his marriage. It's important to note that Todd's talking about people who experience everyday common depression tendencies versus those who need like legit professional help. So we know you guys are going to get a lot out of this episode. Here we go.
Todd, I'm glad you're here, man.
Hey, good to be here.
Today we have Todd Graham. He's been married to Trina for 19 years. Todd has three kids. He's a speaker. He's an author. He's a pastor. He has been so instrumental in helping form how married people helps couples, helps churches. Just been a great friend to us and such a great, great thinker. I also like to say that Todd is a pastor with a past. And not like that kind of past, but like you don't have... Like when you talk to pastors, they're usually like, yeah, I was at this church, and then I was at this church and different things, and you have served at several churches, but you were a first responder before being a pastor. Talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, while I was pastoring, I was a police officer in a county just north of Atlanta for several years, and I've also worked on their fire department, and I'm part-time in the trauma department at the Children's Hospital in Atlanta.
Okay, Todd, you didn't know I was going to ask you to do this, but I'm going to ask you to share the story about the time you were sitting at Starbucks and you see somebody running in the parking lot and you had to do a get after them or something. Am I remembering that correctly?
I was not in uniform, and the police were outside chasing a vehicle outside of Starbucks when I was having a meeting with another pastor. And they pitted the car, which rolled over, and some guys jumped out and went running and came by through the Starbucks parking lot. And when I looked up, one of them was trying to take a car from somebody who had just pulled in. So I went running out after, but it turns out he was trying to take a car from another police officer from the same department that I work with. But he's a big fella. So we both went after him and jumped on the guy. And when the uniformed police officer showed up, handcuffed the guy, went back in to finish my coffee.
Just another day in the life of being Todd. So I love that. Love that story. So Todd, you and I have talked over the years about many, many things. We've talked about it. You know, Todd's always the buddy I get to talk honestly with about family and about church and ministry and different things. And one of the things that we've talked about often is this whole battle with depression. And, you know, we're reading some stats that said, you know, that nearly 7% of the American population of adults, as many as 16 million people experience clinical depression in any given year. And that's not even to mention people that have mild cases of it. You know, around the world, nearly 350 million people will struggle with depression each year. Yeah, we knew we had to talk about this, Todd. We knew we had to talk about depression. And the reason that I want to talk to you about it is you and I have been very open and honest with it, about our own struggles with it. But I feel like you are probably the most proactive guy with it that I know. Like, it's part of your life. It doesn't define you. It is part of you. But before we get into the how you handle it so well, let's talk a little bit about how has depression impacted you personally, but also you know, as a husband and a dad.
Well, let me step back from it. Me as a pastor, I see it all the time. Somebody who works with married people, and we're very engaged with that. And I do married people events at my own church, but also at others. And anytime there's a group there, you got to realize it's impacting so many people. And the thing about the depression topic is that it never just impacts the person who's dealing with it. It always plays a major role in their marriage, whether they know it or not. And it's something that people don't talk about, because when people have depression, they don't know what to do about it, and they don't speak out about it, and they don't get help. It's become sort of this taboo topic, and there's so many lonely people there, even when they're surrounded with groups of people. You can be in a room with 300 people and still have that emptiness. And so it's everywhere. You know, people are dealing with it. We just don't know their extent. Me personally, I've struggled with it as well for years, probably most of my life, in and out. And I, like everybody I just said, have kept it quiet and don't talk about it. And it's astounding the number of leaders that also deal with it, like high capacity leaders who are helping other people out. They deal with it just as much as the average person.
Todd, why do you think people suffer in silence with this? Why is this different than, let's say, somebody that struggles with diabetes, high blood pressure, whatever the thing is? Why do we not talk about it? Because it is a chemical thing.
Sure, absolutely. Most of the people I talk with that are dealing with it, that's a question that comes up. Why aren't we discussing it? Why are you scared? And a lot of the times I feel like things like diabetes, like you mentioned, or other issues are provable. You can document them. You can put them on paper. You can see a result. You can do their clear action steps to reverse or take care of most issues that are physical. And the mental or emotional ones are more difficult. And there's so many threaded layers to say the words depression or burned out. There's so many different types, and there's not really a catch-all, and there's not really an immediate solvable solution. So I think a lot of people just don't know where to start. And actually, a lot of people that I deal with, including myself for a while, didn't even realize that they were dealing with it. It's not something that comes on quickly that has telltale signs. It's something you gradually wake up one day, unless somebody points it out to you, didn't even know you were dealing with it.
Talk to people a little bit who are listening to this who just don't get it. Like, they don't get depression, and they're like, just change your attitude, man. Just look at this thing a different way. You're just being a pessimist. Like, talk to people that really just don't understand.
Man, that is one of the biggest struggles, which again turns around and makes people who are dealing with it not want to talk about it because they don't feel like anybody understands it. It's not something that you can just turn off or turn on. It actually takes them over. And again, they don't realize that when somebody's struggling or dealing with depression, they don't know how to fix it, number one. Nobody wants to be unhappy. But when you're dealing with depression, it's kind of like a black hole. You don't really know how, and don't want to get out of it at the time, because nothing feels right or okay. And any strides that you make to reverse it don't work right away. It's not like you can turn a light on in a dark room and solve the problem. Because when depression can also, it impacts you chemically, which is something you can't necessarily control. And it's going to take a while to reverse some of those things. A mindset change happens over a long period of time. Your body plays a lot with it, how you're taking care of that. So it's not just an outlook or a decision. It's a multifaceted thing that takes over all of you, physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. So you can't just solve that because you decide to one day.
Because I think that's another thing too, especially in the Christian space, where we say, you know, isn't Jesus enough? You know, aren't you, you're not being spiritual enough. What do you say to those folks?
I say that's just one more reason why people won't talk about it. You know, I've seen so many people come into my office hurt by that. They want to know what's wrong with them, why they're broken. If they are Christians, if they are following Jesus, why? Then what's wrong? Because Christ is supposed to be our joy. Yeah, but if things aren't working out in your head, and things aren't working out, and everybody has seasons, everybody on the planet has seasons where things just aren't going right. And if you're having a hard time figuring that out, it doesn't mean you're broken, and it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with your relationship with Jesus. Those are the ones that he went after.
What we're not saying here, Todd, I know, is that it's not okay to be sad, and if there's something, you know, if you're sad, something's wrong with you chemically. What's the difference between someone who may experience sadness, which I think we all do, and someone that would say, no, it's deeper than that? And what's the difference between sadness and depression?
Sure. Everyone experiences sadness. And one of the main myths about depression is that it is sadness. It's not just that. Sadness is just a byproduct. You can be depressed and not actually hit the sadness. Depression is, and or burnout is, when the passion of life actually fades. Your desire to do things that make life what it is, it goes away. And so even wanting to get out of that, that fades as well. And you gradually become cynical and you feel drained mentally, emotionally. And again, it bleeds over physically. And you can do that. You can get numb without necessarily being sad. And everybody has sad days. Everybody has down days. But when you get to the point where it lasts for multiple days in a row, or you have frequent episodes of this that come closer together, then you might start thinking, maybe I'm dealing with some depression, which is, that word deal with is sort of interesting, because most people aren't dealing with it. They're experiencing it. Dealing with it is the difference between people who are going to be able to start to do something about it and not, when you're actually dealing with it.
So when you think about, and I want to make sure that we come back to that, because we want to get really applicable on this thing, because I think, again, that's why I want to talk to you, because I feel like you've really fight it in a great way. Sure. You know, you really deal with it in a great way. What are the differences that you see with people in depression? Because it's not just sadness. You know, I know for some people, they struggle when they're depressed, that makes them angry. You know, they're angry. What's that? Is there a difference between men and women? How do you see it manifest itself in different ways for people who think it's just, you know, I'm just Eeyore, I'm just sad.
Right.
And people that are experiencing it in different ways.
Well, guys do have a tendency to get a little angrier about it. Just in general, these can be traits for both men and women. But for the ones who come into my office that we talk a lot, guys get angry because guys are fixers. And when they can't just fix this and things don't feel right, they just feel broken, they just can't fix it, they have a tendency to get angry. Women have more of a tendency to be more sad about it, because they're sad that they're sad all the time and can't figure out why. Little things will, some of the other clues are, little things will get you disproportionately angry or frustrated. Stuff that shouldn't be a big deal becomes a big deal, or things that are big deals all of a sudden aren't big deals anymore, and you stop taking care of your critical things, including self-care and the people around you. And passion in life fades. Stuff that you would normally like to go do doesn't excite you anymore. The people that would normally charge you up don't charge you up anymore. Events and things that you would enjoy doing, just, it loses its appeal. And some people will start sleeping more, just to get away from it, because their body feels lethargic, because their head's lethargic, and it's a circle that just keeps wrapping around itself. Laughter goes away. It's replaced with a lot of times a cynicism. And productivity, when your productivity is dropping and you can't figure out why what's happening, those are all hints.
That's maybe been going on for a while. Like, again, these are not sporadic things. These are things like, I'm getting into a cycle here.
Yeah, that's the thing. Everything I just said is completely normal. There are no red flags individually about anything I just said. Mm-hmm. Everybody feels like that at some time or other. But when it becomes more of a habit or something that's a constant for you, those are signs that things may be starting to tilt.
Gotcha. So tell me a little bit about, let's talk a little bit to people who are married to someone that they either know they struggle with depression, or they suspect that they struggle with depression. What do they do?
Right. Well, again, let's jump back to what we said at the beginning, is a lot of times people don't know. You don't realize you're dealing with it because, again, everybody has bumps in the road and you learn to manage those. And eventually, if you're not managing it anymore, that's when it starts to overtake you and you don't realize it a lot. And it can be very difficult for the person who's dealing with depression to explain or communicate exactly how dark it gets on the inside. Because most of the ones that I've talked with have learned to manage, and they're trying to deal with it. They've learned to cope with it, learned to hide it, learned to say, well, I can get over this and beat this. So to be able to communicate with your spouse exactly how dark that feeling is and how desperate you can be on the inside can be very difficult. So if your spouse actually tries to explain that they're dealing with this to you, then realize the effort that took, and they're probably not going to the depths of how they're feeling about it, because they're just trying to figure this out on their own. And a lot of times it can be very emotive, and it's hard to separate between marital issues and this depression, because we count on each other to lift each other up a lot in our marriages. And so when it doesn't feel like one of the spouses is up and energized by their relationship, all of a sudden that can fraudulently feel like the marriage is broken or something's wrong between them, which is not necessarily the case, but is often, very often considered the case. That can leave the other spouse wondering what they've done, what they would have, could have, should have done, and then all of a sudden they'll go into fix-it mode or defensive mode when they figure out that they've done everything that they could. And it really has nothing to do with them, which is hard not to take it personal when 50% of you is dealing with something that's traumatizing.
So you took two categories there. You said they either try to fix it or they get defensive. Talk a little bit about those two lanes.
Sure. Men in particular are fixers. They want to fix and just press the right button and make their spouse happy and make things okay again. And if their spouse is dealing with something like depression, there is no quick fix, but they're going to want to, and that's their natural go-to. Actually, men or women, if your spouse looks or feels or expresses that they're broken, if you love that person, you're going to want to fix it just because you want them to feel better. But with depression, another person can't fix you.
One of the things Nancy and I have talked about often on this podcast, or at least I've talked about it often on this podcast, is when we came to the revelation of, she said, I don't want you to fix it, I want you to feel it. And so do you see that lane happening for men and women? Do you feel like that men are trying to fix women more, or do you think women are more like, well, he just feels this way? Do you see that there's a gender trend there, or do you think everybody's wanting to fix it?
When it gets to this point, everybody's wanting to fix it, and you do have your leaning tendencies, and women will want to try to feel that for their spouses often, but they can't. Like I said earlier, it's hard to explain how dark it gets. And men don't necessarily need somebody else to feel it, but just to have somebody understand,
right,
or get that's what's going on, and that helps a lot.
Gotcha. What about the defensive part? Talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, when your spouse is dealing with something like this, your natural tendency, like I said, is to try to fix it. But when fixing doesn't work for so long, the spouse who's not dealing with it runs out of ideas and runs out of energy. And it's very easy for them to go, hey, I've done my best here, and I'm not good enough for you somehow. What am I missing? And they can internalize it and feel like they're broken. So you end up with two people who feel like their relationship is busted because they're not working well for each other when it has nothing to do with that. And so it's easy to get defensive when you've done your very best, things that have worked before, or you're putting all your effort into this marriage, and there's nothing positive coming out of it. It can feel like they aren't enough for the other spouse.
And that's tough.
Very. That's tough.
Because I do think culturally, we think that marriage is supposed to do a lot of things for us, right? People, they don't have low expectations of what marriage is supposed to be delivering. I mean, in our minds and culturally, it's supposed to, you know, we're supposed to be, you know, this is my soulmate, you know, you complete me, you know, if we were just better connected, if we could talk better, if we could do all these different things better. So I think people have these huge expectations, and then when they aren't living up to it, boy, that's a struggle. That's a lot of struggle for people. So again, so we know depression's real. We know that people are struggling with it. I love the fact that over the last few years, it's been okay to talk about depression. It's been an okay thing that we can discuss. And I love right now that I feel like the church over the last few years, I think Kay Warren from Saddleback Church, she's married to Rick Warren, co-pastors of Saddleback Church. Their son, Matthew, committed suicide after years of struggle. And we knew them personally, and just watching how much she struggled and he struggled to help their son. I mean, there's no family in the world that has poured more into a kid than they did. And so they, being the people they are, they're like, we want to like not let this be in vain. And so they're like, church, we got to start talking about this. We've got to elevate this. We've got to make people feel like that if they're feeling like that, that they're not broken and that the church is here for them. Have you seen a change, or do you feel like we've got a long way to go when it comes to how the church and Christians are handling depression?
Both of those, absolutely. We are talking about it more, mostly because the media is putting these tragic stories out, and we need to know. We need to talk about it. But there are so many different levels of depression and burnout here that a lot of it could be stopped before it really gets heavy or gets intense just by talking about it, or just by man, if somebody just looked at somebody who's starting to deal with it and said, you're not crazy, there's nothing broke about you, you're just having a season right now, you're going to work through it, and we're going to work through it, and you are going to be okay. Just to hear those words would change the game for so many people before they get further down that road. And there's a big difference between clinical depression versus regular everyday that we're starting to see that's really being triggered and sparked by anxiety and such with the fast-paced lifestyles that we live. And we can do something especially about that second part. And so many other people who are dealing with legitimate chemical imbalances that need help, if they can just get more comfortable talking about it, then they can get the help that they need, and we can stop this problem on all levels.
Wow. So both of them, both levels, mild and major depression, or this one, depression that's kind of brought on by anxiety or situations, and this chemical one, all starts with us talking about it, all of starting to tell them it's okay, making that a safe place. So that has been, you know, everything gets bashed about social media and different things, and we all know there are some terrible things there, but I do feel like that social media has actually elevated this whole idea that we've got to talk about this. So Todd, once again, the reason I'm so excited that you were going to share with us today was the fact of how you've handled your own depression in such a proactive way, even on days that you didn't feel about it. I mean, you've modeled that for me. You've helped me with my depression dramatically with your approach toward it. Talk a little bit about how did you get to where you are? What are the things that you do when you're struggling with depression, when you're in the middle of it, or you feel it coming on, or what do you do to every day to kind of keep it at bay? Tell us a little bit about your story of depression and how you started going, I need to do something different.
Sure. Those are great questions. The thing that happened first is I didn't know I was dealing with it. I read a blog post by Carrie Newhoff a while back, and he was listing off the top a few things that define burnout. Those are hints or clues that you're burning out. And that's such a great word that I love, because that's really what it is. The fire, the passion for life burns bright sometimes. And when things are burning out, it fizzles. There's no more warmth. You can't see through the smoke. There's no more fuel to actually burn. And I read that article and I got down and I was all 11 of them. I'm like, oh man, this is what was happening. Nobody in my family ever talked about this. I didn't have friends that talked about it. And so that was my wake up call. Well, then you had to figure out what am I going to do with it? And here's what I found out works best. And for me, and it seems to be helping friends or people that come in for counseling, I pick one thing in each of these categories to do a day. One thing physically, one thing mentally, one thing spiritually, every day. So I got three things on my checkoff list. If nothing else happens for the day, if I'm struggling or dealing with one of those dark or down seasons, I try to pick off one thing a day. I am a runner. I'm glad this is a podcast and not a video. I do not look like a runner. Everyone would have chuckled. I don't have runner's legs. They're short and chunky, and I'm slow. But I'll get in over 1,000 miles this year. Most of those are to prevent the darkness from taking me over. Physically, do something. Go for a run. Go for a walk. Go for a hike. Get outside. That's been scientifically proven. Indoors is your enemy if you're dealing with depression or downness. But you can always do something physically, and that will chemically change your head, and it will chemically change your blood, and it will make you healthier. It doesn't matter. If you can just get in half a mile walk, if that's what you can pull yourself to, it's been proven to change the game for you.
Todd, you and I have talked about this whole running thing before. And I remember calling you one year and I said, hey, I usually outrun the depression. This year it caught me. I can't outrun it. And there's been times I've gone to the gym before and we were trying to do a class and I just got about 5 minutes in and I just physically felt I can't do this and literally walked out of the class. And even with running, sometimes I'd be like, gosh, I'm running, but it's still catching me. How do you... You know, people have a hard enough time exercising as it is, you know, just as the general public goes, I'll do it tomorrow. You know, it's no fun. People are busy. How do you get yourself up off the couch? If somebody's right now, they're listening to this and they're depressed and you're saying, go for a run. I'd do 1,000 miles a year. how do they take that first step?
There, that first step is just getting out the door. Go for a walk. Last night, I slated myself for a big, long run. I went for a one-mile walk instead. It's just about getting out and getting one foot in front of the other. It's do something. The enemy to this whole depression thing, regardless of what level that you're dealing with it, is this. Do something. Because when it's eating you, you want to do nothing. Your desires, your cravings, your tendency when you're dealing with downness or depression or burnout is to do the polar opposite of what's going to fix you, which is what makes it so rough. Mm. You want to be still. You want to go in bed, which is the opposite of what you need. You want to eat junk food, and that's the opposite of what you need. It's another thing. It's the small choices. Just legitimately walking a quarter of a mile is a better choice than sitting on the couch for 15 minutes, and it'll change the game. Legitimately, one meal at a time, pick something that grows instead of something that was manufactured or fried, and it will physically, chemically change you. So those are the physical decisions you can make. Everything counts. Doesn't matter how big or small it is, everything counts.
Well, we talked about, you know, depression's got a lot of chemical components to it. And absolutely. Exercise, I mean, it just does everything great for your brain. Yep. I mean, in terms of what you need and how you feel, like it is, you know, I've read studies before of people with major depression. They say that the exercise does as much or more than the antidepressant. And some people, we are not bagging antidepressants whatsoever. For some people, that is a great answer for them. But they will say that exercise is always a great companion to that. And sometimes it can even replace it.
Yes, absolutely. If you need to take your meds, then take your meds. You'll get back in balance. But you got to let the doctor work with the doctors if you're at that level. If you're not, then you need to understand that those medications are actually fabrications of what your body normally puts into your bloodstream to make you well and whole. So yeah, the physical stuff is a game changer.
The food, you know, and I think that's, you know, I talked to a friend's a nurse, and she said I had one class in college, you know, nursing school about diet, one, and nutrition, the whole thing, you know. And so I think a lot of times, you know, you go in, I feel depressed, you can get the pills, and that may be exactly what you need. But I think we are doing people a disservice by not telling them the natural things that they can do, because those are powerful, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And that gives you control. You have control to help this. This is the dealing with it part. Experiencing depression versus dealing with it. The dealing with it is when you're doing something about it.
I love that. So you're talking, okay, so diet and exercise, things people heard, but gosh, we want to bang on the table right now to go, wow, these are so important. What else?
Always do something mentally for you that's going to progress you. I do two things every day. Number one, I try to read. I'm a reader, not by nature, but because I know it betters me, and it makes my mind stronger. It gives you something else to focus on. It puts you in the learning process, which is a part of your brain that's deactivated when you're dealing with depression. You don't learn things. You don't want to learn things. The thought of progression is difficult at that phase. So if you force yourself to go learn something, whether it's a arts, crafts, something interesting about music, any kind of book that you can read is going to activate a part of your brain that is not wanting to function right then, and it will help kickstart you out of this circle that you're in. And I also use a five-minute journal. Do you know what that is?
Tell me what the five-minute journal is.
You need a five-minute journal. It's 5 minutes of the day. It starts off with three things that you're grateful for, which is something, again, that's not activated when you're in your dark hole of depression. And when you can activate the things that you are grateful for, it brings up happy spots in your life. It brings up blessings, things that are going right when things don't feel like they are at all.
What are you grateful for, Todd? What are your three things today?
Ted Lowe and this podcast. That's important.
That's not the real things.
Oh man, this morning I wrote my kids, even though I've got teenagers and I struggle to be a good dad.
It's hard to be thankful for those kind of kids.
They're awesome, and I love them to pieces. They're at the top. My wife is on there this morning. She's a fantastic lady. She celebrates everything. She keeps a calendar of freaky holidays across the world, and so we're going to celebrate something every day at our house.
What's the oddest holiday you guys have celebrated?
Oh, goodness me. We were not a hockey family, but we celebrate Canada Day, and we'll get food and have flags.
That's awesome. I love it.
Another throw to Carrie Newhoff, my favorite Canadian.
Love it. I love it.
So yeah, the thankfulness is important. The 5-minute journal helps me do that a lot. Then at the end of the day, it also closes you out. So it starts your day on the upbeat, but it closes you out with one thing that happened during the day that you're grateful for. Mm. So I wake up and go to bed with positive thoughts. And they have done a lot of research on that 5-minute journal to show the benefits of that and keeping you in a positive headspace. That's important.
Yeah, absolutely.
Then spiritually, I try to do one thing every day, and that's the tough one because you don't see it, and there's not necessarily immediate effects. And if you're feeling down, we have this fraudulent thought of being close to God or far away from God. None of that's legitimate. You know, we're as close to God as we can be. He loves us so incredibly much. So I try to get into His Word or a devotional just to keep me connected every day, and it's such a game changer.
So Todd, off that comment, you said it's hard when people hear, you know, Jesus should be enough. What's wrong with you? Shouldn't Jesus be enough? And then I hear you say you need to spend time with Jesus. Tell me how those two things work together. I understand what they mean, but I want to make sure that our listeners do too.
Just knowing that God loves you and understanding and believing full force that Jesus came and died for you and wants you to live a better story, that's great. But it doesn't fix things around you. It gives you a new perspective on how to deal with things. And it's our goal and our job to become love a little bit more every day. And when you're dealing with darkness or depression, it's harder to do that. It's harder to be that love for other people every day, which it makes us more Christ-like. But knowing who Jesus is isn't the answer. Adding Him back into your daily equation when you're just trying to figure out life is. Mm.
Because I loved it, Todd. I wish people could see the look on your face when you said He just loves us so much. Because I know you know that. I know you know that, believe that. And I think, could not agree with you more. When you sit in that realization, when we don't use those phrases to slam somebody or try to fix somebody, but He really does love us so, so much. And you think about your own kids and how much you love them. And I know people like right now that are listening, they just don't feel lovable. Depressed people, a lot of times they don't feel lovable.
Absolutely.
They feel, you know, insignificant or worthless, or they're not adding value, and that lies start telling them, you know, emotions lie, and they tell us things that aren't true. And I think that's why sometimes people hurt themselves, just because they believe the lie.
Oh, yeah. The voices in your head. I have a friend who doesn't usually talk about emotions lying. He says the voices in your head, that don't listen to the voices. They're not legit. They're not real, but those voices and those emotions can get so very loud when you're hitting a dark space. But you got to remember and write it down if you need to. They lie. It's just not real. It's not who the Bible says you are. It's not who your loved ones say who you are. And when you're at your best, you know that's not you.
Love that. So I love that. So physical, mental, spiritual. I like that.
Just one thing every day, and it's not going to knock it out of the park every day. These aren't going to be quick fixes, but they are the roads to recovery. It's the road for keeping your head about you and helps the dark times not stay so dark, and it can greatly decrease the length that you're on that road.
Gotcha. Talk a little bit about your views on medication and where those fit in.
Absolutely. Man, God designed the brain so incredibly. We have so many different routes, and we can physically get off chemically. And when you're at the space where you can handle and manage and deal with yourself, you need to do everything in your power to do that. There are cases chemically where people need help, and God places doctors around with the brains to figure out what can help us. And so medications can be so incredibly important for those people who need them. Stay on them. Work through them. And anybody who says that people shouldn't take medications for things like that are speaking out of great ignorance. I don't think they're trying to be mean, but they don't understand the topic and they don't know what they're dealing with. Because nobody would stay in a dark place if given the opportunity. But sometimes we just need some help, and that's the route to go.
It's not always the answer, but sometimes it is, right? Yeah,
that's okay.
It's okay. Todd, this is so helpful, and I think it's so hopeful. So talk to people right now who feel like they don't feel a lot of hope with this.
Yeah, those are people guaranteed listening to the lies in their head. The dream is this, you know, experience that they would experience life fully every day. But if you're not there right now, then take it moment by moment. The hope is that you're here. You have brought, anybody listening, you've brought a smile to somebody's face. You've changed somebody's day. And when that's our goal again, we can make somebody smile, make somebody's day, then you're fulfilling your purpose here. And then you find you have meaning. It's so hard to find hope when you're in that dark space because you don't feel like you have the capacity or like you're worth it or you don't have value. That's how I can probably explain it best. You feel like you don't have value to yourself and those around you. And that's just not true. And you can go out and prove it by doing something for somebody.
And that's another great step for, you know, that's proven over and over in research. Just a lot of times we're depressed. Stop thinking about you for a little bit. And that's not a slam on that. It's just go help somebody.
Absolutely.
Go help somebody. And it's the isolation too. Talk a little bit about the importance of community or letting people in.
Wow. Isolation is one of those things that kills all relationships. It's what we say at Married People. Isolation is what kills marriages. And that's one of the very difficult things about dealing with depression is you do feel isolated. You don't feel like anybody understands you. You don't feel like anyone gets you. And that is actually why talking about it helps so tremendously, because you realize all of a sudden, oh, wait, this many people out of a group of 10 is dealing with this too. They all have down seasons. They all have down times. Absolutely. It's not just you. And just knowing that alleviates so much stress. And please, anybody listening, you are not isolated. You're not the only person dealing or impacted by this. And same thing I would say to spouses who are trying to walk through and live with a spouse who deals with depression. You're not isolated either. There's so many other spouses in your position. You're doing a great thing. Keep up the work. No, you're not alone in this. And avoid the isolation to the best of your ability. It's important that you get out and still see people, still be around groups. Even if all you can muster is that quarter mile walk we talked about earlier, smile and wave at the neighbors when you go by. That counts. Everything counts. Don't physically put yourself in the isolation spot where emotionally you're feeling at the time. Hmm. You have to fight it again. That's the horrible thing about dealing with depression and burnout is your body craves the things that it needs the least.
Hmm.
And isolation is one of those things you'll be drawn to, and it's a killer.
Your body craves what you need the least, which is isolation, too much sleep.
Or just stagnant, sitting still, watching the TV instead of getting out. You physically shut down. You crave junk food. I don't know how many people come through my office when they're depressed and they bring in a bag of Fritos and a 32-ounce drink. You just it's those self-medications that we try to deal with.
So Racetrack and Quick Trip in the South is not the answer. It seems like it's the answer.
It's the answer for most things in the South, but not for depression.
I did tell Nancy once, I wish the food economy was flipped, that everything in Racetrack was actually healthy. Like, I would love to just eat all that junk and it would be good for him, but it's not. So we have to stay away from Racetrack. But that's interesting though. Your body craves what it needs the least. That's important. I think too, I don't know, for me, when I'm getting in that place, I don't want to be around people, but if I'll make myself be around people, it really does change things. Because the next thing you know, you're like, oh, I'm not thinking about me, or I'm not thinking about this heaviness or this darkness. Wow, I forgot about it for a little bit. Because that's the thing isolation does. You just can't forget about it. Yeah. No wonder you want to go to sleep. You're tired, ready to get out of your own head, right?
Yep.
And so you go, oh, that just feels, catching a movie, or doing this, just, as our pastor Andy Stanley says, just do the next right thing.
Yes, absolutely. And it's the last thing you're going to want to do. You're not going to want to be around people. You're not going to think it works. Same thing with the eating, the physical stuff, the meal. You're not going to want to do it. And it always is surprising because it works.
It works. So we say every week on the podcast that we want to give people one simple thing. And when you and I were talking about this earlier, you go, Ted, it kind of doesn't work like this in the land of depression. So what would you say, if you could help us hone it down just a little bit, you know, somebody, because I know depression overwhelms people, right?
Sure.
Too many action steps, too many things. So talk one simple thing for those who are struggling with depression themselves.
Absolutely. And let me jump back. The reason I told you you can't pick one thing, it's even one thing that'll work for somebody who's dealing with depression, that same thing may not work the next time because it revolves and it evolves and it tries to work its way around on you. But my one thing I would suggest is to do one thing. Pick. We gave lots of ideas on the do one thing physically, mentally, spiritually. That's what I pick. So I do three things a day. But if you just want to start, pick one healthy thing for you and just do that each day. And if nothing else, by the end of the year, you made 365 awesome choices.
That's good.
And if you just pick one thing, if you want the physical category, mental category, or a spiritual category, just pick one. And if that works and you got a few more minutes in your day, do one from the next category.
You know why people should listen to you right now, Todd?
Why is that?
Because this is real to you. Because this is you. You don't have rose-colored glasses. You're not someone who's learned about this, and you're talking about all those who experience this. You experience it yourself, and you fight for yourself and for your family, and I love that. So as people are listening, because I know when people are depressed, you, like you said, you become cynical, and you're like, none of that's going to work. But it really, really does. It's these simple things that can make a big difference a lot of times, right?
Absolutely. And let me make a disclaimer to everybody who's out there who hides this very well. Nobody who knows me, who listens to this podcast, is going to believe that this was me doing it. I have become a master.
Are we outing you a little bit?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I'm a master at hiding it. A lot of people are, and that's okay. You still need to talk and communicate. Get out there, work your way through these steps. It doesn't matter what you think people are going to think about you and how well you've learned to hide it. It's still impacting you, and this is really going to make you a better version of you.
I love that. Now, give us one simple thing for those whose spouse struggles with depression.
I have one, but it's going to be tough. It's don't take it personal. And how do you not take it personal when it's your spouse and it's half of your life and it's sleeping next to you at night? It's a struggle, but don't take it personal. And here's what you can do. It's going to be super positive. Continue to answer their question. At Married People, every guy has a question and every girl has a question. And it's the same question they keep from the time that they're little until the time that they pass away. And if we can answer this for our spouse, you're going to have a great marriage. And here's this. Men want to know, do I have what it takes? And if the wife can answer that in some way every day, it helps tremendously. And women always want to know, would you pick me again? And if men can somehow, whether that's why bringing flowers works, that's why poems still work after all these years, that's why looking them in the face and reminding them that you love them, that's why it works. So answer your spouse's question every day, regardless of how they respond, and you've done your best.
Todd, thank you so much. This is so helpful. Thanks for fighting the fight. Thanks for modeling that for us. Thanks for being my buddy. Thanks for helping me on this journey. It's not fun a lot of days, but you have made it a whole lot better, and I love you for it, bud.
Hey, love you too, buddy. Thank you.
Thanks again for listening to the Married People Podcast. If you liked this episode, be sure to subscribe and leave us a review. That helps us reach more people with the podcast. And if you want more marriage resources, check out our website at marriedpeople.org. Until next time, I'm Afton, and thanks for listening.